Good morning. How's everybody doing? March weather, late March weather, actually, isn't it? Awesome. It's beautiful. Who needs to go to Florida? They're missing out. It's good to see everybody here this morning. If you have your Bibles, your iPads, your iPhones, whatever you follow along in, I need you to turn to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. We all want happiness, don't we? Coming out of the Christmas season, and you guys know what happens here in Holmes County, in America. There are Christmas gifts bought galore, just tons of them. On Black Friday, it's one of the biggest retail manias that ever was, and it probably ever will be. I hope there's nothing that gets more intense than that. I did it once, thought I could attain happiness by getting a big screen TV, and I sat in line outside of Sears. Becky and I did, so I'm going to include her in this because it wasn't just me. We thought we would get this awesome deal on a big screen TV, and this is about, what, 3 or 4 years ago, Beck? Something like that. We sat outside of Sears from midnight to about 3 o'clock in the morning. We were in line standing out there freezing. We thought if we could get this TV, we would be happy. And because it was such a good deal. You can't not buy this TV. I mean, you know, you ladies know what I'm talking about. These deals are so good. You're making money by buying them. And I'll never forget, I was standing out there with a guy, and through this nonchalant conversation, I find out that he's waiting on the same TV. Well, online, if you looked online, they had 3 of them. Well, this is 1, 2. Guess what, buddy? I'm getting one, you're getting the other one. I don't know who the other one is, but the rest of them are all out of luck. The door opens, I forget what time of the morning the Sears door opened, and just this mayhem and mad rush throughout for happiness. Right? I'm going to be watching a very distinctly clear TV tonight. And so I run up to the electronics section, and guess who was right in front of me? This guy. He's number 1 and I'm number 2. It's not how it was outside, but now that we're inside the store, he's in front of me, I'm behind him, and I'm patiently waiting. They were like, "Sir, can we help you?" And he said, "Yeah, I would like this TV." And I knew what he wanted. We had been talking about it out there. And she said, "I'm sorry, sir, we don't have any here." I wasn't happy. I was not happy. And I started like, now, wait a minute. If she told him that they don't have any, they're not going to have any for me either. And we didn't get one. We didn't get one. And so the advertisement in the paper and everything that it was saying they had in stock on, you know, online, we could see that the Philly store actually had one. They didn't have one. And there I was all night long waiting on happiness that I could not get. You guys have all been there, right? This Christmas, something really interesting happened. We bought gifts for our kids, just same as everybody in here buys gifts for their children. And most kids are anticipating toys or something fun, right? And we did that. We bought all, you know, fun stuff. But the one box for our youngest had snow gear in it, like AJ has. Gotta have what AJ has, you know. And so there was these coveralls to go out in the snow, boots, and the whole get-up to go out and sled and play in the snow. He opens the box in anticipation of happiness. There was necessity in there, and it was sheer disappointment. Runs off crying, "I don't want it, I don't want it," you know, that type of thing. So we're all striving for happiness. Did you know? I better look at my notes because there's some statistics that I do want to give you this morning that are about modern America. Our seeking of happiness, we don't seem to find even though we seek it in every direction. That's all the world tries to teach us to do, is find happiness, find happiness, find happiness. And in that searching for happiness, we're not doing a very good job of finding it. Because when we do find it, it just seems like we need more. And coming out of the Christmas season, I know it's just common that out of the Christmas season, there's this void that fills people. It's just there. There's an emptiness that is there, and there's more depression, more suicides, more things like that happen right after Christmas season than any other time in the world. Why is that? Because we're feeding on the wrong stuff. Statistics say this: 1 out of every 10 Americans over the age of 12 is clinically depressed. Okay? There are over 40 different brand name antidepressant medications available on the market today, prescription-wise. 40. And in the past 15 years, the use of those medications has went up over 400%. Are we happy? And yet, that's we want happiness. Just like Mason wanted happiness on Christmas. Just like I wanted happiness on Christmas or on Black Friday with my TV. I didn't get it. Had I got it, I have to be honest, I did go buy one. I went to Millersburg Electric that very day and bought one for full price because I was upset. It's like, I'm going to have one. Should have bought a new crossbow, right? So anyway. Are we doing well in our pursuit for happiness? With all the new research, I mean, obviously in the past 15 years, 400% more use of medication for antidepressants, that means that they're doing new research, they're coming out with new products that will make you happy, that will take and numb the pain of real life, right? Is that really the answer? Or could it be that the answer is quite old? That's where I want to take you, to Matthew chapter 5. It's a common scripture. Matthew talks about, you guys know it as the Beatitudes or the Sermon on the Mount. And there's a few things that I want to take into consideration about this message that Jesus preached that day. There's a lot of good messages that Jesus preached. However, I feel this one here is probably one of the most popular ones in script that you would read of. The where was this message taking place? If you guys turn to Matthew chapter 5 in verse 1, he says this way, and seeing the multitudes, which tells me that what Jesus was doing on earth at that time was bringing together large crowds of people. It doesn't say that all these people that were following him or getting close to him, it doesn't say they were all believers of his. He was just doing some wonderful stuff, some out-of-the-box stuff that drew attention to him, and they all wanted to be close and see what Jesus was going to do next. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. He went up into a mountain. Now, if you guys remember last year, I had the message on Moses when he went up onto the mountain. We were doing the story. You guys remember when he went up into Mount Sinai, he had taken, Moses was basically the prophetic figure of who Jesus was going to be. He was going to lead a group of people out of bondage, is what Moses did. In prophecy of what Jesus would do. You can take, Google can be your friend, but you can do a lot of cross-referencing between Moses and Jesus, and there's very many similarities between the two as far as what they did here on earth. So Moses takes a group of people way back out of Egypt, out of bondage, and takes them to Mount Sinai, and there at Mount Sinai is where God gives him the law, the Ten Commandments. You guys remember that? And when he comes down, they were doing what? All kinds of crazy stuff. They were worshiping a golden calf. They had done all these crazy things. Moses breaks the law, literally. And God makes a covenant right then and there with his people at Mount Sinai. And I think it's very intriguing that Jesus preaches this particular message on a mountain in that very same setting. Who was there? It says in verse 1, and when he was, well, you know, the multitudes were there. It says it in verse 1, and his disciples came up to him. So you know the disciples were there, right? And I think this is a vision of what it's supposed to look like, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. It gives truth to those who follow Jesus, which are his disciples, and it invites those who don't follow him yet but are curious. I think that the disciples, the 12 of them, were sitting right there close to Jesus, and Jesus literally was teaching them. But when he was teaching them, while he was teaching them, the multitude was out around him and looking in, and they were impressed and curious of what that teaching was all about. Doesn't say they were all believers, not yet. But the primary audience was for the disciples. And if you guys can look at yourselves here at Light in the Valley, if you're a follower of Christ, if you believe that Jesus died for your sins, you're a disciple. So this message that Jesus taught that day is for you. It's specifically for you. However, it was meant to be broadcast for those that didn't believe and make them curious. What is the purpose of this message? What's it supposed to do? This message, blessed are the poor in spirit, all the blessings that go down through there. How does it fit into the theme of God's story? The one we talked about, we did that whole series last year. How does this message fit in? I believe the Sermon on the Mount is a picture of the inside. If you guys can envision with me, the inside of the kingdom of God. This is what, if you lived inside the kingdom of God, this is what life would look like. And we're going to go down through and dissect each one of these verses. But I believe that's what the Sermon on the Mount was meant to be. The kind of life that we're to aspire to. The kind of virtue that the Holy Spirit would produce in us. The kind of character that we ought to be longing for and striving for every day. This message shows us the type of life that we're meant to live. And I think it's interesting, if you read these, that Jesus' message doesn't start out with, you should. You should be poor in spirit. You should hunger and thirst after righteousness. You should be meek. It doesn't say that. It says, blessed are. So it's basically Jesus, what he's doing is he's not reprimanding us for not doing it. He's basically creating this picture that if you do this, this is what will happen. And it makes it enticing and it makes it inviting to live this way. So what does blessed actually mean? Blessed, if you look it up, it's just, it's a richer and truer meaning for happiness. We as Americans today, I mean, basically, I'll go back to my little story about the TV. It's my least watched TV today. I don't like it. I wish I wouldn't have it. I like my others better. So we base happiness on how we feel. If it feels good, if it looks good, that's what we base our happiness on. We do that just unintentionally. It's just our nature. We do this type of thing. When actually, in reality, happiness can be a lifestyle. I think the Sermon on the Mount, it refers to a happiness that we all long for. It's a deep and lasting happiness. That's what blessed means. It's not an action. You can't act it out. It's something that you live out. Does that make sense? It's not just an act, because an act, the tale will be told if you just act like a Christian. But if you live like a Christian, that's your life. And you'll see as we go down through here, the depth of this message was incredible. This happiness that he's talking about is not contingent on circumstances. In other words, Jesus didn't say, blessed are you when you fell in love, or blessed are you when the stock market went up, or blessed are you when you got your new job, or blessed are you, you fill in the blanks of the things that we talk about all the time here on earth. That's not what Jesus is talking about. He was speaking of something way more enduring, way more permanent. There's a blessing in being blessed. And yet we often think, man, if I could have more money, if God would give me more riches and more fame and more of this and more of that. Those are the things that we long for so much that we think will make us happy, when in reality they don't. If we could shoot a bigger buck, I'll hush. Doesn't bring us lasting happiness. Those are joys in life that we have just because we're human beings and we enjoy life. But it doesn't bring enduring, permanent blessing. Verse 3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Who are the poor in spirit? Who are the poor in spirit? I believe the poor in spirit are those that have a keen awareness of their nothingness to an awesome God. It's not those who think they have it all together spiritually, like if you were to live like me, your life would be better, or the reason that you're going through some of the trials you're going through is because your faith isn't as big as mine, or any of those types of connotations that we put around ourselves sometimes because we tend to look down our nose on somebody that doesn't have it quite like we do. That's not poor in spirit. Poor in spirit is realizing that God is an awesome, awesome, holy God, and that us, we, human beings in our human nature, being aware of the nothingness that we actually are. Now, God loves us. We are his children. We'll get to that. But in the grand scheme of things, we are nothing compared to God. And I think that's the poor in spirit that he's talking about. Opposite of the world's value system, opposite of being so self-confident, so self-reliant, if you put your mind to it, you can do it. That's the world's theology. That's the world's belief. I believe there is power in positive thinking. I do. But I think we need to be careful also that we give God room to work and the Holy Spirit room to work in our lives, and not just think, just because I think it, just because I put my mind to it, I can do it. It's only by the grace of God that we can do these things. Are you poor in spirit? Do you recognize your nothingness before an almighty God? That's the poor in spirit. And it says, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Verse 4 says, blessed are they that mourn. Now, this isn't talking about people that have a melancholy personality that walk around with a sad face all the time and cry at the drop of a hat. That's not what he's talking about. Well, who are they that mourn? I was asking Becky, when is the last time that you and I sat down and actually cried and lamented the fact of where the world is and the condition that it's in because of the brokenness? When's the last time that you sat down and shed a tear for a loved one that you know is living a sinful life? Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. You can't be comforted. You don't understand this comfort if you're not broken to the fact that some of your family might not be living right, or some of your best friends might be involved in things they shouldn't be. You can't get this comfort if you don't lament to that and grieve over some of the things that are going on in the world. It breaks my heart. But am I doing anything about it? Do I cry out to God on behalf of my brother who's living a sinful life? And you guys know the story. I'm not going to say his name. How often do you see me on my knees crying out to the fact that he's lost? That's the mourning that he's talking about here. We all know these people. We live with these people. We rub shoulders with these people every day. Does it break our heart to the point that we literally break down and cry out to God and say, God, please have mercy on their souls? Because you won't understand the comfort that Jesus is talking about if you're not grieving about those things. There's no way. Verse 5, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Meekness. It's not how you act. Again, you can only put an act on for so long, and then it'll call your bluff. You will default back to the proud, haughty person that you are if you don't live inside of meekness. What is meekness? It's an humble self-forgetfulness, being submitted to God, not being self-pitying or self-loathing, not worrying about what other people think of you. That's a big one for me. That's a big one for me. I'm worried sometimes about what people think about me if I say this or if I do this. If I stand for Christ in this area, what will they think? I won't be cool. Blessed are the meek. The meek are people that don't fight for their own agenda. They only fight for Christ. And the meek actually trust God to take care of them. It's not all about me. I can do this on my own. I've been successful my whole life, and I can conquer till the end. That is not a meek person. And it says the meek shall inherit the earth. As a Christian, you guys know this. My age group of people here most likely became Christians at the beginning to escape hell, right? Like we think, and maybe we still think, I used to think that if I die, I get to go to heaven. And it says the meek will inherit the earth. Think about this. If we're living inside of this kingdom of God the way that he designed it to be, can't we bring heaven down? Can't the new earth, John in Revelation chapter 21, John said that he's seen a new heaven in a vision. He's seen a new heaven and a new earth, an earth that was sin-free, an earth that was pain-free. It was death-free, tear-free, all of that. He's seen that. And I believe we as Christians are commissioned to be meek enough that we inherit the new earth here. We bring a little bit of heaven down. You guys will hear me say this. If you don't like it, you don't have to show up, I guess. But after next Sunday, you'll probably hear me say that a lot yet. I believe it's our responsibility as Christians to bring a little bit of heaven down here on earth. And that's what he's talking about, inheriting the earth. And we can't do it with a proud and a boastful spirit. It won't work. It can't. Verse 6. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. What is hunger and thirst? I'll take a drink right now. A hunger is a longing or a craving for something, right? And they don't go away until we eat something. Last year, I went on a diet. And the first three nights were horrible. The first night I prayed, I said, God, I've overcome alcohol and drugs and things, and none of it was this hard. And so you're going to have to help me because this is food. And I was struggling bad. I mean, I wasn't supposed to have anything that was looked good. And I could not. My stomach just rolled and roared, and I was hungry. And it would not go away until I ate something. You have to actually eat something to get that craving to go away. And Jesus is saying, blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. It was interesting. The other night I ran into one of my long, not lost, But a friend from long ago, I actually went to church with him in 15 years ago, we started going to church together. And it was just interesting. He stood there and we talked, and I know the guys that were with me were getting frustrated, but it was just like that we hadn't talked in such a long time. And he was like, "Jimmy, I can't believe it." He said, "I look back at where God took me from, and I look back where God took you from, and look where you're at today. Look where I'm at today." He's a youth pastor now and doing crazy things for God, and the conversations that we had 15 years ago, okay, versus now. He said, "Jimmy, I can't wait to find out more about God." He said, me and my wife sit up to late hours looking through the Bible, finding new things, Holy Spirit stuff and healing. And he said, "We're going after things that give life." And I said, "Oh, believe me, I know how it is." I remember when Becky and I first made a real commitment to Christ, we could not get enough. There was a hunger and a thirst. We would sit up. I literally remember having prayer at 3 a.m. to close our devotional. Where's that at? Do we still do that? Are we that hungry and are we that thirsty for righteousness? Do we want it that bad? And it was just good to see this guy, and I trust that he can say the same thing. Wow, you know what? I know that Jimmy's a changed guy from where we were 15 years ago, because the conversations we had back then weren't like they were the other night. So God has a way of taking us through baby steps and keeping us hungry. There are so many things. I don't know if I live to be 100 years old, I won't know it all about the Bible. And I'm excited to learn more and more and more about it. How many of you agree with me? It's an awesome thing. It's never, ever dull. It never gets old to learn more about God and righteousness. Verse 7, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy." Who are the merciful? They're the compassionate, they're the generous people. These are the people that don't just know about suffering. They hear somebody went through a hard time. They hear somebody's going through a struggle. That's one thing we can all, every one of us from this seat all the way to back to that seat, if we were to say we know somebody that's struggling with something, we know somebody that's suffering from something, from the loss of loved ones, from cancer, from sickness, whatever it is, financial loss, marriage problems, we all know somebody that falls into that category. We all know it. But the merciful that he's talking about are the ones that act on it and actually do something about it. And it's not like it's a barter with God. You can't say, "Well, if I show mercy, God's going to show me mercy." That's not what he's talking about. That's not what he's talking about. I used to think that's how it was. But the irony of mercy is this: if you're not merciful, it isn't that God isn't willing to give you mercy. It's actually that you're not able to receive it. That's a strong statement, I know it is, but think about it like this. God made a way through salvation, right? That's a divine gift, and it's the biggest act of mercy known to mankind, is salvation. However, it goes right along with what I was saying. The irony of it is, if you can't give mercy, you're not able to receive it, is if you can't receive salvation if your heart is hardened. You can't. You won't believe it. It's the easiest thing to believe in, but it takes faith. Here's my favorite one. Verse 8. "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." And I tell you, who among us has a pure heart? I remember thinking, and I think I've said this before, I'll just say it again. As a kid, I used to think, well, there's no way. I mean, if I could just see God in this way, if I get my fingertips on the door frame of heaven and pull myself up and just get a glimpse of him, I'll be counting it good. Because there's no way in the world, living in the technology that we do, there is no way in the world that you can seclude yourself to the point that you won't be bombarded with evil. Evil thoughts, evil images. I mean, the list goes on and on. We won't get too graphic on that. You guys know what I'm talking about. How can you stay pure in thought, pure in mind, pure in heart, with all of this evil influxing in on us? I'll never see God that way. How can anyone ever have a pure enough heart? I'll tell you how. Get a new one. Get a new one. Have a heart transplant. There's only one way that you can do it, and that's through Jesus. You can't get a pure heart by trying to be like him. You can only get it after you incorporate your life with him, and he becomes an everyday iconic figure in your life. It's who you become. It's not who you act like. You can act like Jesus for a season. You can act like you're meek for a season. But it becomes a lifestyle. And then it says that they shall see God. What does that mean? And I remember so well as a kid, I thought, I took it literally, like, we'll get to see God. And that is a benefit of it. I do believe that with my whole heart. I believe we'll be put into spirits that we can actually tangibly see him. We could not behold him with our human bodies the way they are right now. But I believe one day we will see him, but I don't think that's what Jesus is talking about here. I think what he meant here is they shall see God, they will know him, they will experience him, they will walk with him every single day. Knowing God is seeing God. Verse 9, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Peacemakers, right? Not peacekeepers. Now, you guys know me. I don't like confrontation. I will run from confrontation. But when I do get cornered, I will confront. You know what I mean? Beck? No? But I don't like confrontation. I will do everything I can to walk away from confrontation. I'm a peacekeeper. I like to keep peace. I don't like arguments. I don't like creating arguments. So what is a peacemaker? Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Peacemakers are those people who run headlong into situations that aren't at peace. They run headlong into it and find a solution and make peace. That's what a peacemaker is. They don't shy away from the confrontation and the hard conversations. I do sometimes. I'm trying to be a man and like man up and not do that, but it's tough. Those are tough things to do. And yet, blessed are the peacemakers, for they should be called the children of God. Why? Why would they be called the children of God? It's because God is a peacemaker. He is the ultimate peacemaker. Think about it. He sent Jesus to die, his only son, to die, to come down and make peace once and for all. That's a peacemaker. And when you follow and you're a child of his, a son or a daughter of God, it makes you a peacemaker because you're his child. Verse 10, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The worship team can come up. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake. And I tell you, this persecution is not talking about because you're weird or you're obnoxious or you stand for something. This is for righteousness' sake. It's not because you have an idea, oh, they rejected my idea because maybe because of you think it's because of who you are or because of where you're from. They're not taking my idea. That's not what Jesus is talking about. He's talking about actually being persecuted for righteousness' sake. Jesus didn't get killed by going with the flow. He didn't. That's not what killed him. He was killed because of righteousness. He was killed for righteousness' sake. So he has the right to teach us how to take persecution for righteousness' sake. He has the right. He did it. It's where righteousness brought him into conflict with unrighteousness. And unrighteousness thought it would win, and it didn't. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. I'll read the last two verses. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you, verse 11, and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. And that's how I'll close today. The Beatitudes, the Sermon on the Mount, that life that you see inside, if you stepped inside the kingdom of heaven, if you looked inside there at how that's supposed to look, it is impossible to live that way apart from grace. It's only by the grace of God. No one can naturally live this way. We default to pride. We default to all of these things. And yet, if we live this way, we'll be happy. True happiness comes by living this way. I believe this message this morning is, if you're here and you're not saved, it's for you. You're in the multitude that was outside. And I hope by looking in at everyone here at Light in the Valley, this is for you too. The disciples were right up around Jesus and he preached to them and he said, if you do these things, blessed are the meek, blessed are the pure in heart, blessed are they that get persecuted for righteousness' sake. All of those things will bring you, it's a recipe for happiness. And as we go through 2017, I trust that each and every one of us can attain to that. Live to that. Ask the Holy Spirit to guide us, to give us more hunger and more thirst after righteousness. Deep down inside, that's what we all want. And we get wrapped up in this world and we think these things are going to bring us happiness. And I believe Jesus gave us the ultimate recipe. You guys will stand with me. We'll pray.